your work, you've done a lot of research on what regulates these different clocks. Yeah. There's a master regulator clock, and there's other clocks in different organs. Maybe you can explain. But I read somewhere that something between like 10 to 15% of the entire protein coding human genome is actually regulated by these circadian clocks. And anywhere between around like 40 to 50% of those genes are actually involved in metabolism.
Yeah.
So there's a wide variety of processes that are regulated by these clocks.
Yeah.
Maybe can you explain a little bit about the central master clock and what regulates that?
Because so this is a field of study that is actually not driven by a disease, but pure curiosity. So for a long time, people thought that there might be a master clock in the brain because we always connect circadian clock to sleep-wake cycle. And fortunately, there was actually a master clock. And in fact, almost 40, 45 years ago, people who were working on different parts of the brain, because at that time, 40 years ago, people thought that different parts of the brain regulate different behavior. So there are defined like cubic millimeter area of brain that regulate something. So they were systematically taking out parts of the brain in mouse, rodents, in different larger rodents, and then figured out that when they hit this small part of the brain called suprachiasmatic nucleus, so that means we know that our eyes send optic nerves that crisscross, and there is a part of the brain called optic chiasma. So it's above the optic chiasma, so that's a suprachiasmatic nucleus. So that's...
Say that 10 times fast.
Yeah, suprachiasmatic nucleus, or SCN. And it's composed of around, say, 100,000 neurons, I guess, in humans. Really small, maybe 1 millimeter by 1 millimeter. That's the size of this brain part. If you remove that brain part in a hamster, then this hamster will not have any sense of time, will go to sleep at random time and will wake up after 2 or 3 hours and will continue. But what is most exciting is if we take SCN from another hamster and transplant, it's like a brain transplant experiment, then this hamster will get all the rhythms back. That's the earliest example of neural transplant transferring behavior from one animal to another animal. And that essentially established that there is part of the brain that acts as master circadian oscillator or circadian clock because it orchestrates this daily rhythm in waking up and going to sleep. And just imagine, only when we are awake, we eat or we exercise. So that's why all other organs related to eating, for example, our gut, our liver, our fat, all of them are driven by this feeding behavior. Similarly, a muscle is driven by when we run. So that's how the SCN acts as the master circadian oscillator. So if we damage the SCN, then we lose all circadian rhythm. So what happens in some of the neurodegenerative disease, like very advanced stage of Alzheimer's disease, dementia, if the SCN, this part of the brain, is affected, then people lose their sense of time in terms of when they go to bed or when they stay awake. So these patients slowly, they turn into a state where they don't have a sense of day or night. They stay awake throughout the night and maybe sleepy throughout the day. So that's why this master clock is so much important for our health.
Wow. And that may also have a feed-forward loop, because then, you know, if your master clock is thrown off and you're awake when you're supposed to be sleeping and sleeping when you're supposed to be awake, that's also been shown to affect hippocampus and long-term potentiation.
Yeah.
So, you know, you've got this sort of, you know, feed-forward loop.